Ramanujan for G is now available on the Google Play Store. Try it out for free.
So, hi students, in our previous classes, we have seen reversible reactions and also how equilibrium is reached in a reversible reaction. And later on, we defined also what is the equilibrium constant. And that's, I'm just revising it. So, if a reaction, suppose a general reaction is given as A plus B gives A C plus D, gives C plus D, then in such a case, equilibrium constant K we can define as K forward. The rate of forward reaction divided by rate of backward reaction when equilibrium is reached, that will be equal to concentration of product C into concentration of product D divided by concentration of product A into concentration of product B. This is the concentration. This is usually called Kc, because we are defining equilibrium constant here in terms of molar concentration, so we call it as a Kc. And so we have seen few examples there and also some numerical problems. And later on, we have seen how the equilibrium constant is related to different reactions. Suppose if you reverse the reaction, what we will do, the equilibrium constant of a reverse reaction will be equal to 1 divided by equilibrium constant of the forward reaction or reversible reaction in the forward direction, whatever you can say. So similarly, if you multiply this entire equation with a number, suppose this n into a constant or a scalar quantity, n into a plus n into b becomes nc plus nd. And initially what we knew, the reaction was a plus b giving c plus d. So now the equilibrium constant is, the new equilibrium constant will be equilibrium constant of the previous reaction raised to the power n. So if we also if we divide this reaction by a scalar quantity, then what we will do, that again the divide means whatever the power 1 divided by n, so we will put Kc to the power 1 divided by n. This you can simply see correlate from these two reactions, so two equations. Now we'll see a more general reaction. Suppose A moles of A gives B moles of B, reacts with B moles of B and gives C moles of C and D moles of D. Then in such a case, equilibrium constant we write Kc is equal to concentration of C to the power C, whatever the coefficients is here, that is called stoichiometric coefficient. So if we put a stoichiometric coefficient raised to the power of the concentration of whatever the species is there, then D concentration of D raised to the power stoichiometric coefficient of D divided by concentration of A, these are reactants, raised to the power stoichiometric coefficient of A into concentration of B raised to the power stoichiometric coefficient of B. And then later on, if this is C, so what we can also write, this molar concentration and molar, and this will be in the molar concentration. So molar C plus the power will be C plus D minus this power A minus B. So this way you can find out the unit of equilibrium constant. So this will become in the Kc, but this is the way we write the equilibrium constant. If someone asks you to write the unit, then you can find out the unit by this way. Or sometimes what we do, other times we will see, sort of we do not represent, we do not put any unit for equilibrium constant. This is because if you represent this concentration into the standard state, then we only take that numerical value, how many times the value of concentration is with respect to the standard state. That standard state for a solution is 1 molar solution. So whatever the 2 molar is there, so 2 molar divided by 1 molar will, the number will be 2. So only in such case if we write numbers, so we can see that those equilibrium constant we write as if only numbers. So that is okay, those things we'll see in the great details. Then we have also studied the Kp, when all the reactants and products are in the gaseous forms, then, and even if some of the reactants or products are in the gaseous forms, and then we can calculate the Kp. And Kp, what we do, instead of concentration, we just simply write partial pressures of all the reactants and products, and the powers will be the same. So here, this is because we see the partial pressure is proportional to the concentration. We can correlate for an ideal gas from the ideal gas equation. So that is why we write Kp, and another constant will be equal to the partial pressure of product suppose product C raised to the power stoichiometric coefficient of C, then partial pressure of product D raised to the power stoichiometric coefficient of D divided by partial pressure of reactant A, because these are reactants, so they will be in denominator, so raised to the power partial pressure of raised to the power stoichiometric coefficient of A into partial pressure of B raised to the power stoichiometric coefficient of B, which is B here. So this is how, and then again the unit we can write here, atmospheric to the power atm, whatever unit of partial pressure that you are using, that you can put here. So atm, if this is an atm or bar, usually we take bar, so bar C plus D minus A plus B. This way you can easily find out. And now we then later on we saw the relationship between Kp and Kc, and what we derived the equation Kp is equal to Kc into RT to the power delta n, and RT we know usually it's more than one. So based on that, we have also find out the some relations that way, in what cases the Kp will be less than Kc, or when the Kp will be equal to Kc, or Kp will be more than Kc. These things we have seen. You can correlate. Now let's see some questions. So this is how, so what is the Kp at 25 degree centigrade for the following reactions if Kc is 4.2 into 10 to the power minus 2. So this, in this question, the Kc value of Kc is given and the reaction is given, and we know this reaction is also given. So from this reaction, what we can know, the ammonia, it's a gas, we know hydrogen is also a gas, nitrogen is also a gas. So in such a case, this value of delta N we can find out. And the value of delta N that we can convert, delta N is equal to 2 moles of product minus number sum of moles of gaseous reactants is 1 plus 3, it will be 4. So 2 minus 4, it will be minus 2. So delta N will be minus 2 moles. This is because we calculate the number of sum of moles of gaseous products minus sum of number of moles of gaseous reactants. So sum of number of moles of product is 2 here. Again, I am repeating this. So and 1 plus 3, this is 4. So 2 minus 4 is 2 moles. Delta N value is given, and temperature, that value is given, temperature 25 degrees centigrade. It means 298 Kelvin. That you know how you can how to convert degree centigrade into Kelvin. Now R value of R, we should and we know this value of R as well. So value of R is 0.80821, you can write liter atmosphere here per mole per Kelvin. So now we can put the from this equation, Kp is equal to Kc into RT to the power delta N. We have this equation, you should remember this equation, that and Kp that we have to calculate is equal to Kc, value of Kc is given, 4.2 into 10 to the power minus 2 into value of R we know. So this value I am putting here, and temperature is also given, and raised to the power delta n value of R into T whole to the power delta n is minus 2. So what I get here, so 4.2 into 10 to the power minus 2, RT value of RT is 24.45, and this is what I said, value of RT is usually more than 1, and that is why we see here it's more than 1, and if it is more than 1, this is minus 2, so this will go into divide. So 4.2 into 10 to the power minus 2 divided by 24 into 4.5. From this equation, this is what we had seen in our last class. We can easily tell that the value of Kp will be less than value of Kc. So if delta N is negative, then what we find usually Kp is less than Kc, and the final calculation it gives us Kp is equal to 7 into 10 to the power minus 5, which is definitely less than this value. And you know, and this is because whatever the RT to the power is something, whatever comes, it will go into the denominator. And since this value is more than one, so Kp will always be less than Kc in this case if delta N is negative. Now let's see this question. This question we have actually, if you remember, in our last chapter, the thermodynamics, I stopped the chapter at a question, and I said that this question we will solve later on. And now this question, the solution I am providing here, because what I said, that we will be able to understand this after we will understand what is the Kp and how will you define the Kp, that is equilibrium constant in terms of partial pressure. And now that I'm going to solve this question. So the question is that at 60 degree centigrade, nitrogen tetroxide is 50% dissociated. 50% dissociated means at equilibrium, what it is saying, the nitrogen dinitrogen tetroxide, it means N2O4, whatever is given, if you, whatever amount you take, you can consider initial amount, it's 50% is dissociated at 60 degree centigrade at equilibrium. To calculate the standard free energy change at this temperature and at one atmosphere. So what it is asking us to calculate is the value of delta G. And delta G, whether this value we know for the equilibrium reactions or the reversible reactions, but it reached to equilibrium, its value is minus RT ln K. It means minus 2.303 RT log Kp, that you can write here. So let's see how we will solve this equation. This reaction we should write, we can write N2O4 gaseous. It gives 2 moles of NO2 gaseous, NO2. And now initially, suppose I am taking 1 mole of N2O4, dinitrogen tetroxide, then what will initially, there is no product, so 0 moles of NO2 is there. But after a certain time, when equilibrium is reached, what we find that 50% of N2O4 is dissociated. Means 1 mole was taken initially and 50% mean half moles of N2O4 is dissociated. And if 1 mole of N2O4 dissociates, and the, what we see here, it will form 2 moles of NO2. So if half moles of N2O4 is dissociated, it will form 2 into half moles of NO2. It means 2 into half means 1 mole of NO2. And what we know at equilibrium, half moles of N2O4 is there and 1 mole of NO2 is there. Now from this, what we can calculate the mole fractions of N2O4 and NO2. If I calculate mole fraction, we know how to calculate mole fraction. Mole fraction of, and we have studied it earlier, mole fraction of a given species. Suppose I am calculating mole fraction of N2O4, the number of moles of N2O4 at equilibrium is 0.5, that I can write, divided by 0.5 plus 1.0, and this is 1 divided by 3. It means 0.5 divided by 1.5, it's 1 divided by 3. Now mole fraction of XNO2 means NO2, I can calculate the total number of moles, it is 1 at equilibrium, divided by the total number of moles of NO2 divided by total number of moles of all the gaseous species. So that is means divided by 1.5, and this will give me 2 divided by 3. And from the partial, from the mole fractions, we know how can we calculate the partial pressure if you know the total pressure at equilibrium. And the total pressure at equilibrium is given 1 atmospheric pressure here, this question. So total pressure is 1 atmospheric pressure. So partial pressure of N2O4, I can calculate from that. And what I know, the total pressure into the mole fraction of a given gas, it gives us the partial pressure of that gas. So total pressure, and this we have studied the Dalton's law of partial, in the section Dalton's law of partial pressure. You can revise it if you do not remember. So 1 atmospheric pressure, total pressure into mole fraction, 1 divided by 3. So 1 divided by 3 atmospheric pressure will be the partial pressure of N2O4 at this temperature. Now, and at this pressure, partial pressure of NO2 that we can calculate is total pressure into mole fraction of NO2, and mole fraction of NO2, what we have calculated, 2 by divided by 3, and 1 atmospheric pressure is given total pressure, so 2 divided by 3 atmosphere. From here, we know the partial pressures of N2O4 and NO2, then we also, what we know the how we can we calculate the Kp, is the equilibrium constant in terms of partial pressure, and that we know for this equation, it will be the partial pressure of NO2 raised to the power 2, the stoichiometric coefficient of NO2. So this is what partial pressure of NO2 raised to the power 2 divided by partial pressure of N2O4, and its coefficient is 1, so we don't put anything in the power, because that doesn't mean anything. It doesn't give any extra information. So now I can write 2 divided by 3 atmospheric pressure to the square, this is unit, divided by 1 divided by 3 atmospheric pressure, this partial pressure of N2O4. Now I get 4 divided by 3 atm, which means 1.33 PATM. And this unit sometimes, and I have also solved some questions earlier where we put some pressure. If suppose this pressure is in terms of, as I said, the standard, because one atmospheric pressure is given, this pressure, standard pressure is one atmospheric pressure. So in this case, Kp we can write 1.33. Because one standard pressure, if you know, the pressure is one atmospheric pressure, so this will become to 1.33, the Kp will be 1.33. means it's a number, you can put that number into the law, because what we have to calculate is delta Rg, the free energy related to this reaction, the change in energy change related to this reaction, and this is the equation, if you know from the thermodynamics, it gives minus 2.303 Rt log Kp. R and T, value of R here, as I said earlier, so the unit depend on the value of R, it also depends on unit, and the what unit, in what unit you take the value of R, it depends on what unit of the temperature and pressure you are taking in at other in this equation. So here that this is Kelvin something, so you can simply write this, and other way also you can write. So in this case, I have taken the value in the terms of joule per Kelvin per mole, means value of R, so 8.314 joule per Kelvin per mole. And temperature is given 60 degrees centigrade. 60 degrees centigrade means 60 plus 273 means 333 Kelvin into log 1.33, and this gives us log 1.33 is 0.1239. rest of the values are same, and what if we get ultimately is minus 763.8 kilojoule per mole. Delta G is in the negative. Delta G is negative means it tells us that this reaction is spontaneous. It's at the given condition at this temperature. So now this suggests that this reaction will happen in the forward direction. Delta G negative means this only. Now let's see this question. Another question. What happened? The value of Kc is equal to, then this next question, 4.24 at 800 Kelvin for the reaction CO plus H2O giving CO2 plus H2. This is the reaction that is given, and all the reactants and products are in gaseous form. So calculate the equilibrium concentration of CO2, H2 means carbon dioxide, hydrogen, carbon monoxide and water at 800 Kelvin, that's the same temperature. If CO and H2 are present initially at concentration of 0.1 molar each. So the given equation, let us try to solve this question. So reaction, we will first write the reaction. So CO plus H2 giving CO2 plus H2. And what it is saying that at initial concentration, at initial point, at the beginning of reaction, what if they have taken only CO and H2, and both they have taken the concentration of CO and H2 as 0.1 molar. So 0.1 molar, and initially the product with the concentration of product was zero, because in this reaction has just started. So the initial concentration of reactants and products were zero, and CO2 and H2 zero. But what happens at equilibrium? Suppose X mole of CO decomposes. If X mole of CO reacts with some moles, what moles of water it will react? It will react with the only X mole of water as well, because what we see from the stoichiometry of reaction is one mole of CO reacts with one mole of H2O. So X mole of CO, or X mole means X molar of CO, will react with X molar of H2O, and X molar of H2O means at equilibrium the only 0.1 minus X molar of CO will be remaining, because X molar of CO has reacted with H2O and it has given certain products. So like equilibrium, the concentration of CO will be 0.1 minus X molar, and of that of water as well, it will be 0.1 minus X molar, and equilibrium concentration of CO2 and H2 will be X molar and X molar, because one molar of CO forms one mole of CO2, of one mole of CO forms one mole of H2, or one molar, if it is molar, we can write it in the molar, because the molar is nothing but number of moles divided by number of moles in 1 liter. So 1 liter, that is the only term, that is function. So you can directly write molar and mole, you can correlate here. So x molar of CO2 will be formed and x molar of H2 will also be formed here. Now the equilibrium constant, we can write equilibrium constant in terms of that we can write here is the concentration of square CO2 into the concentration of hydrogen divided by concentration of CO into concentration of water. And concentration, I mean, it means concentration is equilibrium concentration. So equilibrium constant of CO2 and H2 both are x. So what we write is x square, and equilibrium constant of CO and H2 both are having minus 0.1 minus x, and the stoichiometric coefficient is 1. So 1 into 1 it will also be square. So from this what we write is x square, it will be equal to, if I try to solve this, this value of Kc is given. This value is here 4.24, that we know. So 4.24 will be here, that value is given, written here. So 4.24, it will multiply with this number. If I try to solve, so x square will be equal to 4.24 into 0.01 plus, if this is a whole square means, if you know, you can easily solve, this is 0.01 minus it will be x square, a square plus b square minus 2ab, so this is a plus x square minus the middle term, that will be 0.1 into 2 into x, so it will be 0.2x, so minus 0.2x is given here. So I have just expanded this term, so 4.24 into this term is given here. Now x square will be equal to, if I multiply 4.24 with all these numbers, what we get is this. And we get this further simplification. What we see here is 4.24 x square and 1 x square is here. If I bring this x square on the right hand side, what I get, 3.24 x square minus this 848 x, and this again, this plus 0.0424, this thing you can see, if this will be equal to 0, simply we can solve, and you know how to solve the quadratic equation. So a quadratic equation, suppose x square plus bx plus c is equal to 0 is given. So in such a case, if we just compare these two reactions, what we get, the value of a will be 3.24 and value of b will be minus 0.848 here, and value of c will be 0.0424, that is given here. And we know what will the roots will be, minus b plus minus root b square minus 4ac. Putting all these values, what will you get? You will get two values of x, and that we get after simplification here, with one with the plus and one with the minus. And so x1 I am writing, it is 0.067, and x2 is another value, it will come into 0.194. So 0.194, this is one thing that we can discard this, because the initial concentration that we have taken is 0.1 only. And if the 0.1 molar of carbon monoxide is given, the maximum product, even if the reaction is fully converted, 100% converted into the product, we can get only 0.1 molar of CO2. That means value of X will be equal to, in that case, even it will be maximum value that we can get is 0.1. So this value that we are getting is unlikely. This is not possible. So this value we discard. So this is a possible. This is a possible value of x that we can get in this condition. So the way this value we take only. So the value of concentration means x will be 0.067. So what we can see, the concentration of CO2 is equal to concentration of hydrogen, that we know, and that is equal to x molar, and x molar is nothing but 0.067 molar here in this case. Now again, concentration of CO and concentration of water we can calculate. Concentration of CO and water, they are equal, and this is equal to 0.1 minus x, and value of x if I put here, what I get is 0.033 molar. So thus this, now we can solve this question, because we have found the concentration, equilibrium concentration of all the chemical species that are present at the equilibrium, and that is present in the equilibrium mixture. And this is the way you can solve similar problems if it come across. So next, let's see another question. So for the equilibrium 2N OCl gives 2NO plus Cl2. The value of equilibrium constant Kc is 3.75 into 10 to the power minus 6 at 1069 Kelvin. Calculate the Kp for the reaction at this temperature. And one question, similar questions we have solved, but there we have seen the value of delta N was negative. In this case, the value of delta N will be positive because the number of gaseous products that we get here is 2 plus 1. In the S2 balanced chemical equation, 2 plus 1 is 3, a minus sum of moles of gaseous reactant is 2. So 3 minus 2, it is 1 plus 1. So value of delta N is plus 1, and the value of delta N is plus 1. So if you remember what I said in the our last class, that if delta N is positive, so what we get, the value of Kp is more than value of Kc. This is one thing. So what we should get, even if you are solving the question this way, it helps you to understand whether your answer is in the right direction or not. So let's see how we solve. So delta N value that we know, 1, and what we know, Kp is equal to Kc into RT to the power delta N. So Kc, the value of Kc is 3.75 into 10 to the power minus 6 that we write here, and R value of R again, what we write is 0.831 into the temperature 1069 Kelvin raised to the power delta N means 1. So that 1 is here. So it's, and after solving this, what we get is Kp is 0.033, and 0.033 means 3.3 into 10 to the power minus 2, which is significantly larger than the Kc, and this is what we can also expect from, because the value of delta N is 1. And even again, if you multiply these two numbers, you will get this value is more than 1. So that is why, because this value is more than 1, then Kp is, and that is why Kp is more than Kc, because of that equation. If you remember, Kp is equal to Kc into R to the power delta N. Now let us see some things about the units of equilibrium constant. That is what I have said earlier. So the value of equilibrium constant Kc can be calculated by substituting the concentration terms in mole per liter. Mole per liter means molar. And for Kp, partial pressure, we can find out unit of Kp in terms of partial pressure. If you put of all the reactants and product, and this Kp will be in terms of Pascal or kilopascal or bar or atmospheric pressure, whatever the unit you take for the partial pressure, Kp will come in that term. And this results in units of equilibrium constant based on molarity or pressure, unless the exponents of both the numerator and denominator are same. And that is one thing. If you like, if you products of numerator and denominator, if their the power terms are that becomes same on the concentration, then only this will be a number unitless. Like in the case of H2 plus I2 that we have seen, H2 plus I2 gives 2HI. So what we see, the total number of products is, number of moles in the product is 2, and then the reactant also it is 2. So 2 minus 2, the delta N is 0. And if delta N is 0 again, so the, what we find, whatever the number of moles that will be there in the equation, that will cancel. This unit will be cancelled. But equilibrium constant can also be expressed as dimensionless quantity if the standard state of reactants and products are specified. For a pure gas, a standard state is 1 bar. 1 bar, no. So therefore, a pressure of 4 bar in a standard state can be expressed as 4 bar divided by 1 bar. It means 4. So this one way you can say 4. The value you can write 4. So the numerical value will not change. What we will get is only we won't have any unit for equilibrium constant in this case, which is a dimensionless, because 4 is the dimensionless number. So if we represent this partial pressure or concentration in terms of in the standard state pressure or standard state concentration, in terms of related to that, then we get only numbers for equilibrium constant and we don't get any unit. So a standard state for a solute in a 1 molar solution is 1 molar solution. A standard state of a solute means in a solution, for a solution, a standard state of solute is 1 molar solution. So if you get, suppose, 5 molar solution is there, or 0.1 molar solution is there. It means if we get 0.1 molar divided by 1 molar, so what we get, the value is 0.1. So again, only you can put only the numerical value and get the equilibrium constant. So the numerical value of equilibrium constant depends on the standard step chosen. Thus, in the system, both Kp and Kc are dimensionless quantities but have different numerical values due to different standard states. And these values are different values because different standard states are there. Now, let's see some of the terms. The homogeneous equilibria. Homogeneous equilibria means the equilibrium in which all the reactants and products are in the same physical state. Same physical state means that they are in the same phase, whether all are gaseous, all are liquid, or all are in solution phase. This is one thing that we will see, and such equilibria we call as a homogeneous equilibria. And the example that we see here, N2 gaseous plus 3H2 gaseous 2NH3, all the gaseous, all the reactions where all the reactants and products are gases, that the equilibria is called homogeneous equilibria. We can tell even if all the reactions, where the solutes are taken, the reactants and products are in the aqueous form, means they are solvated, or even in water or any other solvent, then we can also tell that is a homogeneous equilibria. Like in the case of CH2H2 aqueous plus Br2 aqueous, and the C2H2 Br2, this is also aqueous. So if it is forming, then we can say this is also a homogeneous equilibria that we get here. So another example is like this reaction. You can see this esterification. What is the ester is forming? This is acid and this is alcohol. From both, they are both liquids, and with that, what we get, the ester, which is also a liquid, and water as a product, they are also all are liquid. So this is also an example of homogeneous equilibria. And all the reactions where that we have calculated the Kp recently, they are all example of homogeneous equilibria. Let us see the heterogeneous equilibrium system. The heterogeneous equilibrium system means some of the reactants and products will be in solid, or means their means mixed physical state of reactants and products are formed, or they are present. Then we call such an equilibrium or such equilibrium system as heterogeneous equilibrium system, and the equilibria will be heterogeneous equilibria. For example, the phase change for water. Suppose the water gaseous, it becomes water liquid, means the condensation is happening. So the heterogeneous equilibria will be there because water gas and water liquids are there. So water is in two physical states, two phases. So we call such equilibria as a heterogeneous equilibria. Another example that we can see is calcium hydroxide solid and plus water. This requires water is there, and if it we get, this becomes dissolved, and if it is dissolved, the Ca2 plus calcium 2 plus aqueous, this is dissolved, hydration cell is formed, and plus 2OH minus aqueous, and then we see all the phases, they are all in the same phase, solution phase. So what we these three are in solution phase. This water is liquid, the calcium oxide is in the solution phase, OH minus in solution phase. So what we say, any water is a liquid, calcium hydroxide is in the solid phase. So two physical states we see here. So two physical states in solid here, and solution phase, this is a mistake, solid and solution phase. So we call such equilibrium as a heterogeneous equilibrium. So this is solid and aqueous phase of the solution phase that we write here. So if you can correct this, this is a solution phase. So pure solid and pure liquids have concentrations which can vary only slightly due to temperature changes. This is one thing I have mentioned earlier. I'm again repeating it. For all practical purposes, the concentration of solids and liquids are fixed, and so in the heterogeneous equilibrium system, this thing you should remember. So their concentration is fixed, because even if the slightly temperature change happens, the volume change is very small. And in that small change, what we see, even if the number of moles for a given volume, if you calculate, that will be almost fixed, because with the temperature change in volume is negligible, almost very small. So we do not see any change in the concentration of liquids or solids. So those values are constant. So in the heterogeneous equilibrium systems, we do not consider those values or the values of concentration of solids and liquids, and we simply take the values of the either concentration or the partial pressure of those in the aqueous phase or in the gaseous phase. So the solid and liquid do not appear in expression for the equilibrium constant. You should remember, we do not consider such their concentration in the equilibrium constant expression. That means in this equation, what we will do is we will not write expression in the equilibrium constant expression with the value of concentration of calcium hydroxide in this case. So only partial pressures of gas phase substances or concentration in solutions are included in the expression of equilibrium constant. So this is a solution, so their concentration will be included, and not of this COH or even water is there, the water that we will also not consider. And if we see another example, calcium carbonate is solid, it gives calcium oxide solid plus CO2 gas. So here what we see, if you go to the traditional method, the way we have defined the equilibrium constant, we should write equilibrium constant Kc as concentration of CaO into concentration of CO2 divided by concentration of CaCO3. But what we know, calcium oxide is solid and calcium carbonate is also solid, their concentration will be fixed certain numbers. So this number, that this ratio will always be constant. So what we see is C into constant into concentration of CO2 and some constant into concentration of CO2. What we see, the only variable term here is concentration of CO2. So that will be another kind of constant. So thus we can ignore this. So since CO3 and CaO are both constant, therefore modified equilibrium constant for the thermal decomposition of calcium carbonate will, this can be written K prime C. Means suppose Kc is equal to some constant into concentration of CO2, and that constant we can write Kc divided by that constant value, that this value concentration of CaO divided by CaCO3, and that we can write another constant, that is K prime C is equal to concentration of CO2 gaseous. Or if we have to represent this equilibrium constant in terms of Kp, so what we will write, Kp is equal to partial pressure of CO2. Yeah, because this is only one. So this thing you have to take care while obtaining or finding out what writing the expression for equilibrium constant. So the above equation, this suggests that the equation that we have seen, at the decomposition temperature, a constant concentration of pressure of CO2 is in equilibrium with CaO solid and CaCO3 solid. It means that this constant composition or concentration or pressure of CO2 was in equilibrium with the solid CaO and solid CaCO3. Those things that you can determine simply. Now, experimentally, it has been found that at 1100 Kelvin, the pressure of CO2 in equilibrium with calcium carbonate and calcium oxide is 2×10⁵ Pascal. So equilibrium constant for CO2, that thermal decomposition of calcium carbonate we can write, and that will be equal to, as per this equation that we have later calculated this, so Kp will be equal to partial pressure of CO2. So you can simply write Kp is equal to partial pressure of CO2, and that we can write in terms of bar in the standard state. So this we can divide it by, this is 2×10⁵ Pascal. We know this is 10⁵ Pascal is 1 bar, and 1 bar pressure is a standard pressure. So if I divide this by 1 bar pressure, I get whatever the value I get, it is, the value is 2. So what I write, 2 is the equilibrium constant for this, yes, decomposition reaction. In the another case, in the equilibrium between nickel carbon monoxide and nickel carbonyl, the nickel carbonyl, this complex is formed, suppose this coordination complex, and nickel is a solid, it is a solid metal. You know carbon monoxide is gas, this is also you know, and this, but we form is, this is in a gaseous state, suppose. Then the equilibrium constant is written in this case as Kc will be equal to concentration of nickel tetracarbonyl gaseous divided by concentration of carbon monoxide raised to the power 4 is because of the stoichiometric coefficient of CO that we have written here. So this way you write the equilibrium constant for this reaction. I don't write anything for nickel, because we consider that as a constant. So in the equation Ag2 solid means silver oxide plus 2HNO3, which is aqueous. This is also a heterogeneous reaction. You see one solid, one is aqueous. So 2HgNO3 aqueous plus H2 liquid, and what here we have another liquid is also there. In this case, Kc will be equal to concentration of AgNO3 raised to the power 2, because we write this correlation, stoichiometric coefficient raised to the power concentration of AgNO3 divided by concentration of HNO3 raised to the power 2 because of this coefficient. And now what we do not write is, this is a pure liquid. Water is pure liquid. You do not write anything concentration of pure water, because we know its concentration is 55.5, it's a constant. And for a solid, it will also be constant. So these two constants will be another constant. We do not write in the expression for Kc. These examples tell us this. Let's see another question. This questions we take that value of Kp for the reaction CO2 plus carbon. This CO2 is in the gaseous form and carbon is in the solid state, giving 2CO gaseous is 3.0. So Kp is given at 100 Kelvin. If initially partial pressure of carbon dioxide, means that of reactant, is 0.48 bar. And partial pressure of carbon monoxide is 0 bar, it means they have taken only carbon dioxide in the initial mixture. So we started this reaction with only carbon dioxide and plus some carbon solid, and pure graphite is present. As it says, calculate the equilibrium partial pressure of Cu and CO2. So the equilibrium partial pressure we have to calculate, and similar question we have solved earlier. Let us see this. Let's consider X be the decrease in pressure of CO2 from the initial condition. So suppose X mole of X pressure that we write in the terms of bar here. So X bar pressure of the CO2 means X bar of CO2 is decomposed, but it reacts with graphite to form 2X bar of carbon monoxide, because 1 mole of CO2 reacts with 1 mole of graphite and it forms 2 moles of carbon monoxide. So what we see, the and mole we know because of the Avogadro's law, directly proportional to the pressure, and that's something we can correlate. So if 1 mole of CO2 forms 2 mole of CO, it means 1 bar of CO2 will form 2 bar of CO. It means if I consider X bar of CO2 is reacting with C, means it's forming carbon monoxide, is utilized to form carbon monoxide, it means 2x bar of CO will be formed at the equilibrium. So what we write this equation, CO2 gas plus carbon solid, this is for graphite, and 2CO gaseous. And initially what we have seen, the concentration or the partial pressure of CO was 0 and some graphite was taken. This we are not interested in because this is in a solid state, and the pressure of CO2 was 0.48 initially. Now at equilibrium, what we have considered is X bar of CO2 has reacted with graphite and formed 2x bar of CO at equilibrium, because if this is X, the reacting 2x of CO will be formed. This we know. So what will be the remaining amount of CO2? So the remaining pressure of CO2 will be 0.48 minus X bar, because 48 was the initial pressure and X was reacted. It is now had been utilized, so it will be 0.48 minus X bar. Now we can write the Kp value of Kp, equation for Kp will be equal to partial pressure of CO to the square. So partial pressure of CO2, whatever we will get, it's a square of that we will take, because the 2 is the stoichiometric coefficient for CO here, and divided by partial pressure of CO2. Partial pressure of CO2 we write, and value of Kp is given, is 3 in this question. Now the partial pressure of CO that we have considered equilibrium is 2x, so 2x square that we take, divided by partial pressure of CO2, so 0.48 minus x. Now what we do is 2x square whole square means 4x square is equal to 3 into this term, going to multiply 0.48 minus x. Now that means 4x square plus, if I multiply this 3 into 0.48, I get 1.44 minus 3 into x, 3x. So 4x square, if I bring this term, these entire terms, this side, left hand side, so 4x square plus 3x minus 1.44 will be 0. And again, this is the quadratic equation. You know how to solve. So in this equation, the x is equal to minus b plus minus square root b square minus 4ac divided by 2a. And these values we put. The value of b is here, minus b will be 3. So minus b is minus 3 plus minus root b square 3 square minus 4. A value of a is 4 here. C is minus 1.44. So value of c is minus 1.44 divided by 2 into a is 4 again. Now after doing this, what we get? Minus 3 plus minus 5.66. This value gives us 5.66. If suppose I take only negative value, what will get? The pressure will get in negative. Negative pressure doesn't mean anything. It's not a physically possible thing. So what we say, pressure, the lowest pressure could be the zero pressure. So that value we will ignore. So what we take, the minus 3 plus 5.66 divided by 8, that root we take of the what this equation will only take. It means the value of x that we get is 0.33 after solving this. 0.33 means the value of x that we get is 0.33. So the concentration of CO2, if I have to calculate, so what will I get at equilibrium? 0.48 minus 0.33, and minus 0.33 means what you get is 0.15 bar. Well, this is bar, this is also bar. Now the partial pressure of CO, if I have to calculate, this will be 2 into x, and 2 into x is 2 into 0.33 bar, it means 0.66 bar. And this way we have solved this question again. Now let us see some salient features of equilibrium constants, two of the things we have seen earlier. And this is a kind of revision again, because these few points are very important. Some of the additional points are also given here. So expression for equilibrium constant is applicable only at equilibrium state. This thing we have seen. So we write this expression only if the reaction has achieved the or reached the equilibrium. For other concentration, or if the reaction has not reached the equilibrium, we cannot write the expression for equilibrium constant. Those values, whatever we will obtain, that value will not give us the equilibrium constant. It simply means this. The value of equilibrium constant is independent of initial concentration of the reactants and products. This is what I have said earlier. So equilibrium constant is temperature dependent. So it is only temperature dependent, and having one unique value for a particular reaction represented by a balanced equation at a given temperature. So for a particular temperature, value of equilibrium constant will be a constant value. This is what you have to remember, and it is not dependent on the partial pressure or the concentration. It depends on the temperature, and for a particular temperature this value will be constant. The equilibrium constant for the reverse reaction is equal to the inverse of the equilibrium constant for the forward reaction. These things we have seen in great details. The equilibrium constant K for a reaction is related to the equilibrium constant of the corresponding reaction, whose equation is obtained by multiplying or dividing or subtracting or adding the equation for the original reaction by a small integer, a small number, whatever those things that we have seen earlier. In details, so those things we have to consider. Now let us see applications of equilibrium constant. So what things, what informations that we get from the value of equilibrium constant? So equilibrium constant helps us in understanding few things, very few very important things about a reversible reaction. So it helps us in predicting the extent of reaction, to what extent the reaction has proceeded in a certain direction, whether it is forward or reverse direction, is to what extent the product has formed. It tells us about this. It also helps us, or it also gives us information about the direction of reaction. So suppose a reversible reaction is there, and this reaction, whether it has achieved the equilibrium or not, or whether it is going in forward direction or reverse direction, or whether it is at equilibrium, the help of equilibrium constant, we can also have this information. We can correlate, we can calculate certain things, and then we can find out in which direction the reaction is proceeding. And the calculating equilibrium concentration. So with the help of equilibrium constant, we can also calculate the equilibrium concentrations, and this is something that we have seen in last two examples, because equilibrium constant was given and also the initial concentration. Then with the help of that, what we have found is the equilibrium concentration of reactants and products. That thing, it also give us this information. So these three information equilibrium constant give us, they are very important information about reversible reactions. So what does Kamen's equilibrium constant tell us about the extent of a reaction? If I have to find out this, so the numerical value of equilibrium constant for a reaction is indicates the extent of reaction. This is what we see. If the value of K is very high, it means that the product has been formed, or significant amount of product has been formed. Only a smaller amount of, or the very insignificant or tiny amount of reactant was present there. If the value of K is very low in the given direction, it means what is the reaction has not proceeded in that direction to a significant amount or to a significant extent. And that means the reactants are largely unreacted, and that is why value of K is very less. And if the value of K is not very high and not very low, it means if it is in the middle region, it means that some amount of a significant certain amount of product has been formed, though the reactants are also present in the very significant amount. So you can easily measure those things. It tells us. So the equilibrium constant does not give us any information about the rate at which the equilibrium is reached. So it won't tell us about the rate of the reaction. These things, there is a separate thing that we will study. We won't get any information about the rate of the reaction. So magnitude of Kc or Kp, this is not Kc divided by Kp, Kc or Kp, that we know, equilibrium constant in terms of concentration or partial pressure, is directly proportional to the concentration of products and inversely proportional to the concentration of the reactants. And this we have seen the expression for the equilibrium constant. So the partial, which is directly proportional, Kc is directly proportional to the concentration of product. As the concentration of product is more, but we see the Kp will be more simply. So the, if the Kp is high, simply we can find out, tell that the concentration of products is very high. And similarly, Kp means the partial pressure of product is very high. So means the reaction has proceeded in the offset to a significant amount in the forward direction, it tells us. And this information we get from the expression of the equilibrium constant. The partial pressure of product or concentration of products come as the numerator, and that of reactants come as denominator. So if reactants are more in concentration, means the equilibrium constant will be less. So this thing you can understand. So when equilibrium constant K is small, the concentration of the reactants are large as compared to the products at equilibrium. These things I think I have explained, and you can think of. Let's see, some value are being provided. Suppose if the value of Kc is less than 10 to the power minus 3, 10 to the power minus 3 is a smaller number, though if it is less than 10 to the power minus 3 means it's very significantly lower, very small value of Kc if we get. So what we will find out, we'll find out the reactants predominate over products. Means the reactants are largely unreacted, and the only the reactants are mostly being found at the equilibrium mixture. And reaction proceeds rarely. So reaction proceeds rarely means very insignificant amount of product is formed. And such example, if you want to see, you can see the N2, if it reacts with oxygen, it forms 2NO. And for this reaction, the value of Kc that we obtain is 4.8 into 10 to the power minus 31. It is 10 to the power minus 31 at 298 Kelvin, it's very a small amount. So what it means, that N2 and O2 that we see, their concentration is very high in atmosphere in comparison to that of NO. This is because the equilibrium constant is very small. So NO is there, NO, we see NO concentration, certain concentration or amount of NO hydrogen oxide is there in atmosphere, but their concentration is very insignificant in comparison to N2 and O2. This is because of the equilibrium concentration constant is very less. That you can easily understand why NO concentration of NO is very less in atmosphere, though N2 and O2 can react to form this. Now, if the value of Kc is significantly high, it means if it is more than 10 to the power 3, more than 10 to the power 3 means more than 1000, then the what we say the products predominate over reactants and the reaction proceeds normal nearly to completion. If it is more than 10 to the power 3, so what we see the reaction has proceeded almost to the completion. And the examples that we see in the case of H2 plus O2 and 2H2O, it forms an equilibrium constant that we see 10 to the power 47. Though this reaction barrier is very high, rate of this reaction is very low, but water forms and equilibrium constant is very high. That is why we see a very large extent of water in this earth, in oceans and many other water bodies. This means the reaction has proceeded significantly or nearly it has reached to the completion. The completion is H2 plus O2. And all it is, H2 and O2 are they are protected in atmosphere is mostly H2 is very less in amount. It is because of the certain barrier that is associated with the this conversion. Now another example that we see, and similarly if I see this reaction, reverse reaction, H2 plus O2, what I'll get the equilibrium constant will be 1 divided by 2.4 into 10 to the power minus 47. This means what I'll get, it will be around something in terms of 10 to the power minus 48 at 500. At 500 Kelvin, you see at very high temperature remain. So what we see, this is very insignificant amount when the reverse reaction will be formed. And that is why we are struggling to get hydrogen from water in the hydrogen, to use it in the hydrogen fuel cell, and we need catalyst. Research is still going on. Now another example that we see, the hydrogen plus Cl2, it gives 2HCl and 2HCl, that we know that for this the Kc is 10 to the power 31 at 300 Kelvin. So this means the reaction is also nearly to the completion. H2 plus Br2, 2HBr, we know it, we can easily form HCl and HBr from H2Cl2 or H2HBr2. This is because the equilibrium constant for them, these conversions are very high. And the reverse reactions will be very low. So to forming it from HCl to H2, even though in this direction very less amount will be formed. So if we HCl is there, if we put it there, it evaporates because HCl anyway it's a gas at the room temperature. But it remains in the HCl vapor we will find, or even HBr vapor will be there in the atmosphere. It is not H2 and Cl2 or H2 and Br2. If it can form, the problem of acidic rain and these kind of things were not there. Well, those problems are there because this reverse conversion is not very feasible. Now the magnitude of K that we see increasing. So very small K means less than 10 to the power minus 3. What we see means the product is very small. You know, very few molecules of product you can see here. Mostly reactants are there. And if this thing, so if the value of Kc is between 10 to the power minus 3 to 10 to the power plus 3, this is 10 to the power plus 3 here. So if we see such examples, we can see that then the appreciable concentration of both reactants and products are present. And the examples that we see, H2 plus I2 giving Hi, and for this reaction, the Kc is 57, that we see at 700 Kelvin. So significant about of Kc there means H2, I2 and Hi, they are all in equilibrium at given reaction. So these reactions, that is why these reactions you should remember, we generally write as a spontaneous reaction or the irreversible reactions, because the value is, the equilibrium constant is very high. So we write, consider these reactions as mostly irreversible reactions. So these reactions you have might have seen many examples. These reactions, the many numerical problems, we consider these reactions as a reversible reaction, and such examples are there. And this reaction in reverse direction we consider is also a reversible reaction. Anyway, so what we see that for N2O gaseous, the decomposition of N2O4 in gaseous form, again, this the value of Kc that we obtain is 4.64 into 10 to the power minus 6, which is less than, so which is more than 10 to the power minus 3, more than 10 to the power minus 3, and less than 10 to the power plus 3. So it is in this range. So again, in what we see, the Kc is neither too small or too large in this case, and appreciable amount of both reactants and products are being found. And similarly, if the that we see that K is between 10 to the power minus 3 to 10 to the power plus 3, so what we see, the significant number of molecules or comparable number of molecules of reactants and products are there in these examples. And if the K is very large, what we see, the reactants are almost consumed to form product. And very just this representative example, we have seen only one molecule of reactant is there. However, a very large number of molecules of product is formed. So these are things you can simply correlate. Then there are other things that we see this point only this slide and we'll stop. So how does K help us determining the direction of the reaction? So as we say, K also helps us to understand in which direction the reaction is proceeding. So the equilibrium constant helps in finding the direction in which reaction proceeds. For this, we introduce a term, reaction quotient, to find out whether in which direction the reaction will proceed or is proceeding at the given condition. We need to understand if the value of K equilibrium constant for that given reaction is given. We also need to calculate reaction quotient. This is one thing that you should remember. This is a reaction quotient, and the reaction quotient Q, and we get QC or QP. If the QC we get, if the reaction quotient is calculated in terms of molar concentration, and QP when the Q is calculated in terms of partial pressure of reactants and products. So these two terms that we get, and for and there these values are calculated, the expression is similar to that of the equilibrium constant, and that we see for this general reaction A plus BB giving C X. This product earlier we had seen CD plus D C plus DD or D moles of D or C moles of C. Here I have just changed X and Y. So in this case, but we see the reaction equilibrium constant, if the reaction was at equilibrium, we can write equilibrium constant K is equal to concentration of X raised to the power C into concentration of Y raised to the power D divided by concentration of A raised to the power A divided by concentration of B raised to the power B. However, the reaction quotient we can calculate at any concentration at any instant, whether it is at equilibrium or it is about to reach equilibrium, or it is at the just initial stage, or just at the beginning, and anywhere at any instant we can calculate QC. And based on the value of QC, and when we compare this with the K, we can find out in which direction the reaction is proceeding. So the case QC, as I said, similar to equilibrium constant, we can calculate X, concentration of X to the power C into concentration of Y to the power D divided by concentration of A to the power A into concentration of B to the power B. However, these concentrations are not necessarily to be equilibrium concentration. They may be equilibrium concentration, but they are not necessarily be equilibrium concentration. And for the QP also, we can calculate partial pressure of X to the power C and into partial pressure of Y to the power D divided by partial pressure of A to the power A into partial pressure of B to the power B. This is what we see. So now by comparing values of Q with that of K, we can tell the direction in which the reaction is proceeding at a given instant. And this thing, how we will correlate, this thing we will see tomorrow.
Welcome to the Ramanujan app. In this video, we are going to demo JLE topics and its related resources from slides and videos. Kindly give all the necessary permission and proceed to the main screen. Let us select mathematics as our subject. This will open up the syllabus for this subject. All the syllabus data regarding the subject will be loaded at this stage. Once the process is complete, the icon will be active. Zoom a bit so that the topics are clearly visible and click on the orange highlighter button. This will open up a selection box. Adjust the box so that it covers the topic you are interested in. Once this is done, confirm your selection by clicking on the green button. This will download the slides resources for that unit. Once the download is complete, it will ask you for the permission to download the textbooks from the NCERT site. Once the download is complete, it will open up the chapter and the subchapter hierarchy for the unit. Select one of the subchapter. In this case, I am selecting the second subchapter. It will load all the resources pertaining to that topic. Let us click the second icon, that is textbook. You will be given an option if there are many resources. Now you can see, it has directly taken us to the page of the selected topic. Click on the small green button to load all the icons back. Let us click the textbook icon again and select the second option. It will open up a message box, displaying the C-Engage page number for that topic. Similarly, let us select the third icon, that is slides. Let's go with the first option. It will open up the slides for the said topic. Finally, let us select the fifth icon, that is YouTube videos. This will show the videos related to the topic from my IT pal. In this case, there are more than one video. Select any one of the links and watch the video.
Welcome to the second lecture on inverse trigonometric functions.
Similarly, let us select another topic and follow the same procedure. Remember, downloading of slides is a one-time process per unit. Slides are being downloaded here, as we have visited this unit for the first time. The next time we visit the same unit, slides will be retrieved locally. We can also select a topic from slides and get its equivalent matching resource. In this case, I am selecting the topic, straight lines, and getting its equivalent topic from the textbook, that is, straight lines, which comes under coordinate geometry. So here we have textbook resource showing straight lines. Also, we have slide resource showing the slides for straight lines. When there are too many topics selected, or the topic name match is not found, the list of entire topics will be shown to the student. He can select any one topic and proceed further. Now let us see the formula sheet for maths. Formula sheet is provided to get a quick reference of all the formulas covered in the syllabus. If you want to refer to a topic from the formula sheet, simply select the topic and proceed further. We are also providing a link to the CEngage app. On clicking the CEngage icon, it will open the CEngage app. You will find all the test material inside My Bookshelf option. Finally, you can take the mock tests using the National Test Appeals app. Clicking on the icon will take you directly to the National Test Appeals app, where you can try out mock tests. Now let us try out a different subject, that is physics. Let's click on the Moodle icon, seen on the syllabus screen. This will take you to the Moodle calendar, where you will be able to view all the scheduled events. Let us click on one of the events. There is an event for Physics Unit 1. On clicking it, we'll give a live lecture Google Meet link in it. Clicking on the link will directly open up Google Meet app where the lecture will be taken. Let us select a topic from the physics syllabus and proceed further. Now let us click the first icon, that is GyanChat. GyanChat is a medium where the students can interact with the other students via channels. Each subject unit will be having its own dedicated channel. Students can share their doubts or thoughts via this channel. Now let us click on the fourth icon, that is Gyan Moodle. Gyan Moodle would directly take you to the course material for that particular unit. These course materials will be uploaded on Moodle by the lectures. Similarly, let us select another topic and follow the same procedure. Let us click the textbook icon and select the second option. This will open up a message box displaying the page number of the Kindle version of HC Verma book. On clicking OK, it will open up the Kindle app with the book loaded. Once the book is loaded, click on the hamburger icon on the top and select the Go To option. This opens up a dialog box asking you to enter the page number. Enter the same page number, which was shown to you earlier, and click OK. This will directly take you to the page related to the topic you selected. Whenever a QR code is found inside the textbook, the student can select the QR code and he will be provided with e-content material. In this particular case, we have contents related to text PDF, graphic and interactive content. In some cases, there will be video content. Let us select the text PDF content. Since this is an exemplar PDF from the NCERT site, it will ask your permission to download it from the NCERT site. Once the download is complete, it will show the exemplar. Next, let's try the graphic content. It will load the graphical resource for that topic. Finally, the interactive content. It will load the interactive content for that topic. Let us see how video content would look like from a different chapter.
Newton's first law. When you look at force, typically a force is itself defined using Newton's first law. A force is something that pushes or pulls an object and causes it to change direction, stop, change size or shape, or move faster or slower. Now, objects can be with no force. Typically what happens is there is no alteration of either the speed at which the object is moving or the direction in which it is moving. If an object is moving, it changes direction, then too there is a force at play. Force is an external effort that happens to either a body or a system of bodies. It takes an external force to change the what is called the momentum. You already learned about vectors and scalars. Force is a vector and it has an effect on both the scalar value as well as the vector value associated with the body on which it acts. Now, there are two kinds of forces. There are forces that cause action at a distance, and then there are forces that happen because you are in touch, physical touch with the body. Now, but force in either case is external to the body that you are examining. So now let's state Newton's first law. An object remains in a state of rest or uniform velocity in a straight line unless it is acted upon by a force that causes that velocity to change. Thus, it takes a force to be applied to change either the direction, the speed, thus changing the velocity by either changing its speed or its direction. The natural tendency of a body to keep its current velocity is called inertia. When we say inertia, both the speed and the direction stay the same.
We also have live lectures by world-class and dedicated tutors.
Well, that's all for this demo. Thanks for watching.